So today we will talk about for loops in Julia. And for loops execute some portion of code several times over. So to write a for loop, you will do like this. You use the for keyword and in keyword, and you can read it like so. For each I value in the range that we give, execute this portion of code. And the range can be really any iterable object. So it's usually a range, a vector, a tuple, or a string. So let's start with a very simple example. We can take a range from 1 to 3 and print each value of this range. So meaning for each I value in 1, 2, 3, print 1, then 2, then 3. And the output is here, 1, 2, and 3. And as I stated before, we can use any iterable object in the for loop. For example, we just use the range, 1, 2, 3. But we can use also a vector, 3, 4, 5, for example. A tuple, 7, 4, 1. Or a named tuple, for example. Or even a dictionary. And the thing that we have in common between those different iterables is that the for loop will visit every value inside the range. So for example, for the array, it will return 3 and then 4 and then 5 because we visit each value iteratively. But for the dictionary, for example, it will return a pair of key and value because a dictionary is made of a key and a value. But if you prefer, you can iterate over your dictionary by taking the key and the value into separate objects. And you can do it using a tuple here instead of just one object. So instead of I in the range of the dictionary, you will use a tuple of key and the value. And then you can use the key and the value separately. What can you do with a for loop actually? Because it's not very useful to just print the values inside the range. Well, for example, we can sum all the values inside a vector. So in our example here, we initialize x at 0, and then we create a vector with 10 values taken randomly as float 64. So we can print this vector and look inside it. So it's just 10 random values. And then we use a for loop to iterate over each value inside the vector and add these values to x. So here we use the eachindex function because it will compute a range for us for each element inside the vector. And in our example, the result would be the same as saying I want a range from 1 to the length of roundVec. But it is better to use eachindex instead of our own range, and also advised by the Julia community. And so just to be clear here, I takes the value 1, 2, 3 and up until 10, because the length of our array is 10. And we can see that if we print the value of I for each iteration. And so here we see that I takes the value 1 to 10. And so what we really do here inside the for loop is indexing the round vector by I. So by 1 at the beginning up until 10. And so at the first iteration, we take the first value inside the vector, and at the last iteration, we take the last value inside the vector. You can also note that there is the global keyword here, but I will talk about it in a minute. Okay, so now I wanted to show you some helpers with for loops. We already saw eachindex that automatically iterate over all elements of an object. So for a second example here, we use an array with 3 values. And if we use eachindex, it will produce a range with 1, 2, and 3 because there are 3 values inside our vector. What we can use also is the enumerate function. And it works a little bit like eachindex. It produces a range of each value inside an object, but it also returns the value for this iteration. So for example, if we take again the vector with the value 2, 3, and 5, we use enumerate instead of eachindex, and at each step it will return the index inside the vector here, so 1, and also the value 2, and then the index 2, and the value 3, and the index 3, and the value 5. And a little bit like for the dictionaries we saw before, we can use a tuple with the index and the value instead of just I, and then we have inside the for loop an object that is the index and an object that is the value. So for example, here we print the index and the value at each iteration. So at the first iteration, the index of course is 1 and the value is 2, and again on the second iteration, the index is 2, the value is 3, etc. Another useful thing is the continue keyword, and it helps you go to the next iteration without executing the code below inside the function. So what I mean by going to the next iteration is this. So let's say you have a for loop that will iterate 5 times, and we can say that if I takes a value below 3, we will execute the continue statement. And what it means is that the println of I in this case will never be executed because we will go to the next iteration without executing this one. So what we get printed in the console in the end is 3, 4, and 5. Why? Because in the first iteration, I is is below 3. So we hit the continue statement and go directly on the second iteration. Second iteration, I is below 3, continue again. But on the third iteration, I is not below 3 anymore. So we don't execute continue, but execute this line afterwards. And so we print 3. And then again for the fourth iteration, we print 4. And for the last iteration, we print 5. And the last helper I wanted to talk about is break. And break is a little bit like continue, but instead of going to the next iteration, it just breaks the loop. And what we mean by breaking the loop is just stopping the iterations. So in our example here, we again take a range from 1 to 5. And for each value, we test if I is equal to 4. And if it is, we break the loop. So the output here is 1, 2, and 3. Why? Because when I equals 4 on the fourth iteration, we hit the break statement. And then we stop iterating over the range, which also means that we never go on the last iteration. The fifth iteration is never executed. One nice thing about Julia is that we can iterate over two things at the same time. So for example, if you want to iterate over columns and rows of a matrix, you can do this. But to start our example, we can create a 3x3 matrix with only zero values. And then we can use a for loop to iterate over the columns. And inside this for loop, we can again use another for loop to iterate over the rows. And then for each row and column, we can multiply the row index by the column index and assign the result to the position. So the result would be 1, 2, 3, 2, 4, 6, 3, 6, 9. And this is very common to iterate over two things. So in Julia, you can reduce the code to just this. Use the for loop here and iterate over columns and rows in a one-liner. And just so you know, in Julia, it's always better to iterate over the columns in the outer loop and over the rows in the inner loop. And it has to do with how Julia stores the information on your memory. And another very nice thing in Julia is that we have array comprehension. And this is used to create objects very quickly. So for example, here we create an array of random integers and we use the for loop inside the array, and each value inside the array will take the value of I here. And we can do it with dictionaries also. So here we use a for loop to iterate over keys and values, and we make a pair out of the key and the value, and we can make a dictionary out of that. And so the dictionary will be this. And the last thing I wanted to talk about is the scope of the variables inside the for loop. And if you don't know anything about the concept of variable scope, don't worry, it's just an introduction here. There will be a whole video about scope in Julia. But in the meantime, we can say that when we design a for loop, we have to keep in mind two things. The for loop introduces a local scope, which means that all the variables that are created inside the for loop are not available outside of the for loop. And also, the for loop cannot update a global variable if it already exists, because it would make the code very ambiguous. So we have to either explicitly declare the variable local inside the for loop or global to update the variable. So let's take an example here. For example, if I declare a equals 0 and then I iterate over a 1 to 3 range, I can compute a local variable b and I can update the value of a using the value of b. And here Julia is not very happy because b is a local variable, so it is not defined in the outer scope, of course, but a is declared here and also here. So it doesn't know if a is a local variable that we compute but is not accessible outside, or if a is the global a that we want to update. So the solution here is to use the global keyword to say to Julia, okay, we want to update the value of a and not create a local a. And it means that b here will be added to the global variable a that we declared here. So the output at the end is 9. And if we wanted to use a local a instead of the global a, we would remove the global keyword here and declare a local a just before with any value. And then the result here would be equal to 0 because the global a will never be updated. And another simpler way to fix this issue is to work inside a function. So for example, here, if we declare a function that's called test, we could declare a equals 0 and then use the function. And here we don't need the local or global keyword because a is already a local variable inside the function. So here, if we execute test, we will have the value 9 and not 0 because a is already local to the function. So it will be updated inside the for loop. I know it can feel a little bit overwhelming if it's the first time you hear about variable scope, but what I wanted here is to let you know that it exists. And so if you get any issues when developing a for loop, you can go and find the information on from the internet by typing variable scope and for loop. And that concludes the video. Don't forget that this video is part of a playlist, and I see you next time.